But as the audiences grew, so too did Chris Evans' ego. And he wasn't going to take any instructions from Trevor Dann.
I think there was always tension between Chris and Trevor, simply because Trevor wasn't in charge of Chris's show.
Where's my pasta? Where's the pasta?
The problem that we had was that Matthew would say to me, Chris has played a few ridiculous records this morning, go and have a word with him. So I'd go and say, Chris, could you stop playing some of those records? And he would say, no, I'm going to complain to Matthew, because you shouldn't be involved. So then Matthew would call me in and say, go easy on Chris, will you? Because, you know, he's a big talent, we don't want to lose him. And this circle would go round and round. I think I felt that Chris had a bit too much power.
Just a bit too much?
I think he had rather a lot too much, really.
Trevor felt that the one man who could have Chris toe the line was shirking his responsibilities. But Matthew was reluctant to do anything that might upset the man he saw as the station's saviour.
I felt that Chris Evans could break some rules because he was talented, and there were other people who were less talented who shouldn't be breaking rules.
For the first time, cracks were beginning to appear in Trevor and Matthew's 20-year friendship.
My first moment of hesitation was of popping into his office, like I always had done, and he was sitting and writing, and I said, drink at lunchtime? And he went, oh, yes, have a word with Sarah and book yourself an appointment. I thought, this is going to be a different relationship now. It's been made quite clear to me. The guy I'd first met with the beard and the earring and, you know, hanging out with weird actory bohemian types had become this rather kind of stern sort of person. And I found that a difficult thing to get used to.
If he was upset, I'm very sad about it.
By the end of 1996, Matthew's failing relationship with Trevor was not his only problem. Evans had been hitting him with demand after demand. Longer holidays and shorter working hours, and Matthew agreed to them. It was even rumored that Evans had been given unique dispensation to use his personal toaster in BBC premises. More and more people were beginning to think that Evans was out of control.
To call him a monster would not be too much of an exaggeration. I think the success, the adulation, the sycophancy, definitely the sycophancy, all combined and started to push him slightly crazy.
The out-of-control Evans now believed that he alone was responsible for saving Bannister's job and reviving the fortunes of Radio One. Then, one day, an article in the London Evening Standard gave a small share of the credit for the station's success to Trevor Dann. This was all too much for Evans, who, the following morning, announced live to his millions of listeners how much he deplored Trevor Dann, who deserved no credit at all.
People said, did you hear him? No, I didn't, I said. Oh, he had a real pop at you. And I said, I better get a tape. So I rang the production company and said, could you send me a tape of what Chris said this morning? And they said, no, we've been told not to. I said, you've got to stop him doing this. This is just the latest in an outbreak of completely unnecessary defamations. He sat behind his desk and he got very red and he kept seated, which is very, if you're going to get cross, hey, you stand up then. You know, but he sat down in a very, I'm kind of cross sort of way.
I said, that's the way things happen, you know, that's what goes on.
Matthew basically said, well, No, I can't stop him.
And I don't think Trevor was very pleased about that.
Implication being, well, I agree with him. You know, you are, frankly, you are a bit of an arsehole. Basically, that was it. So I just left.
One of the most powerful and feared partnerships in the history of British broadcasting was over. But in an ironic twist, within days of Trevor's departure, the ginger wedge that had come between them would itself be leaving Egton House for the last time.
My PA brought in a note from his agent which said, unless Chris has tomorrow off and every other Friday off for the rest of his contract, we're going to give you notice to quit.
Enough was enough. Now Matthew stood firm in the face of Evans.
And I said, well, if you need to resolve this issue, then you better exercise your notice clause, because I'm not giving you every Friday off. And he just said, fuck off, and stormed out.
Chris Evans was the 23rd DJ to leave Matthew's Radio 1. Although weekly audiences had fallen by 6 million, Britain's youth was returning to the station, and before long, over half the country's 15 to 24-year-olds would be tuning in. In the eyes of the BBC, this was a big success. And 2 years later, Matthew rose to be director of all radio and television production. Trevor, too, was given his own department to run as head of music entertainment. In the last 6 months, however, both men have left the BBC to seek new opportunities. And Radio One, with its new, younger profile, has moved to new premises, leaving behind Egton House, so well loved by the old DJs.
Doesn't it? He just ripped the heart out of the place. Oh, now this, this is gonna freak me out. 306, there's the ladies' loo. And the door's the same colour. Six. Deep breath, guys. Ugh. It all worked in some strange sort of BBC sort of way, and it's all wrecked now.
Blood on the Carpet returns in 2 weeks' time.